weekend that we have had in God's Word. We are finishing up today. This is actually session four. Welcome to the Woven Ladies Retreat. We're happy that you could make it today. We have been with our nose in God's Word and our face before the Lord this weekend, learning what Psalm 139 is speaking to us. And I love this because in the moment that we're studying Psalm 139, on Sunday mornings, we've been in the middle of the life of David. And if you question whether or not God's Word has anything to do, Genesis to Revelation, what do they have in common? I need you to understand something. God has woven every ounce of His Word together for our benefit. From the beginning to the end. It all plays in, every story plays into the next story, every verse to the next verse. It is all because His Word is so alive and so active. So active. It is the one thing that can truly penetrate our hearts to the very marrow of our spirit to change us. And I would challenge you today, if in hearing those words, it's not doing that to you currently in your life, you're not in it deep enough. You're not in it deep enough. Okay, one of the things that I can already tell today, because I could sense it in worship, we're going to need to wake up today. Okay? I'm serious as a heart attack. Wake up today. God did not come to rest in this place so that we would be asleep. He came to waken our spirits, to awaken our senses, and to say, it's time to wake up. So we're going to wake up while we're in God's Word, which means we got to have some interaction. Y'all know I don't play like that, okay? Ask the girls from this weekend. I don't play like that. I need to hear your voices, and I need to understand that you're digesting what the Lord is telling us. So last week, Pastor Edgar, the man of God, the one I want to choke, brought this incredible message of grace to us. And I did quickly remind him come Thursday that next time he decides to preach on grace, he's going to have to give me a two-week warning to prepare my heart, because I don't know about you, but I had ample opportunity to extend grace this week. Anybody? Yeah? The car dealership here in town, I extended some grace. It was really hard, but I extended some grace this week. I hope you found that. So we get to this point in the life of David, and we can look into chapter 10 today, and we see that David had sent his guys. They battled up, and they went into battle, and they were kind of humiliated, and David was like, you're not going to humiliate my men or my God like that. And he goes, and they have this incredible conquering moment. And David was flying on a high because things were good. He had seen God do something amazing. God had yet again proven himself to David. David was confident that God was in control and that he was not, and he was okay with that. But when we start chapter 11, one of the things I find so interesting is the man after God's own heart is exactly like you and I. We see God at work, we see Him move, we see a victory, and we say, yes, God, you are awesome, and then we get lazy. Stephanie, don't call me lazy. Well, call it like I see it. Sometimes we get lazy because we know God's going to do what God can do. We know He's going to bring the victory, and we know that He's in charge and in control, and so we just kind of take a break. In 2 Samuel chapter 11, it says this, verse 1. In the spring, when the kings normally went out to war, David sent out Joab, his servants, and all the Israelites. David sent out. What are we missing right there? All the kings went to war, but what did David do? He sent them out. It doesn't tell me that David went. You know what that tells me? David got lazy. David's taking a break. Verse 2 says this. All right, if we go on, it says, they destroyed the Ammonites and attacked the city of Rabbah, but David stayed in Jerusalem. One evening, David got up from his bed and walked around on the roof of his palace. While he was on the roof, he saw a woman bathing, and she was very beautiful. So, I'm going to stop right there because I giggled when I read this last night. Again, sometimes little crazy things come in my head when I read God's word. David was somewhere that he wasn't supposed to be. He had gone and stayed and been somewhere he wasn't supposed to be. And I was reading this last night, and Rachel was sitting next to me, and I just had this thought of that Garth Brooks song, "And the Thunder Rolls." Remember, he said, he was coming home from somewhere he never should have been. That's David, okay? Sorry. I don't think the Thunder Rolls is about David. I'm just saying that there's some similarities there. That's what I'm saying. Okay. So, David sent his servants to find out who she was. And a servant answered, "That woman is Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam. She is the wife of Uriah the Hittite." So, of course, what did David do? He had been warned right there. Right there, David had sent his servants. Hey, girl. Who is that over there? That servant, y'all, was the flashing light, the stop sign, the whoa, what are we doing here? I love this response because, in my opinion, this servant was very gutsy. Very gutsy. Because he didn't just come back and go, "That's Bathsheba, and she's the daughter of Eliam. That's who she is. She's your neighbor, oh mighty king. I can see what's going on in her face right there, and that's who she is." He actually had the audacity and the boldness to look at his king and say, "Hey, she's the daughter of Eliam, but she's the wife of Uriah the Hittite. David, stop. Stop. Listen to what I'm saying." But David was being lazy. So David sent messengers to bring Bathsheba to him. And when she came to him, he had sexual relations with her. And then she went back to her house. But Bathsheba became pregnant and sent word to David saying, "I am pregnant." Let's pray. Lord, this morning I am so very much aware that there is not a person in this place that came to hear what I have to say. I am acutely aware that your voice is all that matters in this place today. Father, I am asking that your word would literally do what we've already said and penetrate our hearts to the very fiber and the very deepest part of our souls. Father, I'm asking you to search us today because I fear that should you not, some of us that are living a lazy lifestyle are in danger of a big fall. So, Father, in this place, let your word be proclaimed. Let ears hear and let hearts receive today. In Jesus' name, amen. David found himself in this situation that one chapter ago, if you would have told him he was in the middle of, he'd have told you were crazy. He was where he should be. He was seeing God work. He was watching a victory. And in a moment's notice, temptation steps onto the scene. Right in front of David, temptation steps onto the scene, and it all started because David was someplace he wasn't supposed to be. Can I say to you and I today, so often we find ourselves in situations that we ought not to be in. And here's the problem. We want to blame other people for putting us in situations. when the reality is we kicked down the door and walked right on in ourselves. We pulled up a chair, kicked our feet up on the ottoman. David had no business being on the roof that night because he should have been at war with his men. But he decided to take a play off. He decided that he was going to let everybody else go, and they could handle it without him. This morning, in your relationship with the Lord, you can't take a play off. I need you to understand that. I don't care if you're at the top of the top or you're at the bottom of the valley, you can't take a play off. That's not optional for us because the enemy is constantly on the onslaught. I feel like I've said this a thousand times, especially on Wednesday night. He doesn't take a break. He doesn't. He doesn't even take a breath. He is constantly bringing that onslaught in front of us. And if we are not where we're supposed to be, positioned where the Lord wants us to be positioned, which is right here in his word, this is what happens. Temptation flickers. We're not where we're supposed to be. And we want to, first of all, look around and go, well, I'm just, Stephanie, I need to rest. You quit using rest as an excuse to be lazy. Rest and lazy are two very different things, guys. Very different things. You were created. David, in this moment, sees this woman, and his heart is like, it's like lighter fluid on the fire. And what's crazy to me is David had a whole room full of people to choose from. Okay? I was not created to live in those days. I need you to understand that. Okay? He could have walked down to where his wives were, plural, and in that moment, been okay. But instead, he allowed his own want and his own desire to overrule the best. The best. So he marches and he gets Bathsheba and he brings her in. I need you to know today that temptation is always watching and ready at all times to capture you. And here's the funny thing. When we talk about David and Bathsheba, everybody's like, I am not going to be unfaithful to my husband. You know what? This has nothing to do with being unfaithful to your husband unless you're being unfaithful to your husband, and then it's all about that. Or your wife. This is about sin. This is about that thing that you know is a stumbling block for you. This might be the way you talk about people. This might be about a bottle that you run to when you're uncomfortable or you're sad. This is what I'm talking about. What is that thing for you? For David, it was a physical attraction. For David, it was a physical attraction. But that temptation for you and I is watching, and it is waiting for the opportunity to capture your attention and to hold it. We have to know that it isn't always a blatant blindside. It's not always a blatant blindside. It's a slow fade sometimes. Now, I know I probably shouldn't do this, but this one time, I'm going to do it. I'm not going to do it again. The temptation is there. I see it. I know that that's wrong. But this one time. You know what happens? That one time leads to the two times. And the two times leads to the three times. And the three times leads on and on and on and on and on until all of a sudden you're looking around and you're like, how in the Sam Hill did I get here? The one time. The one lazy time that you allowed yourself to excuse the opportunity to indulge in that temptation and that sin. One time. It's all it takes. You know, we tell our kids all the time that either you live in total obedience or you don't. Same application. Either I'm going to be obedient in the hard things and And those moments where that my flesh is screaming, you need that, you want that. Yes, 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 yes. And my spirit is quietly whispering, mm-mm. I got to choose which I'm going to listen to, and I got to choose today, because tomorrow, when that flashing lights and the glitz and the glamour and the this is going to be the best thing for you is happening, I got to know which voice I'm going to follow. And here's the hardest part. I've got to submit to the quiet sometimes over the loud. That still small voice that happens right here. You know, one of the things that Edgar said to us a few weeks ago, and this is so incredibly true, is our choices do not just affect us. They don't. My slow fade, that slow little ebbing away, I almost see it like the waves that come up and the tide comes in and the tide goes out. And we're beach people. We've already established that. I could sit for hours and just listen to that because it's very relaxing to me. Can I tell you that that is the same way the enemy works? Sometimes it's slow and it's just that constant, not a big deal, not a big deal, not a big deal, but it is a big deal. It's a very, very big deal, because once temptation traps you, it will not encourage you to walk in honesty. We know what happens in this story. David does not sleep with Bathsheba and immediately go, I've got to repent. What was I thinking? I have just made a mess. Do you understand? Uriah the Hittite, y'all, was not just a fella over in his army. He was one of David's mighty men. This is the best of the best that David has to offer. The kingdom for protection. These are the guys that he raised up, probably in those caves that Edgar talked about before. Uriah the Hittite was somebody that David knew. I would dare say they might have been friends. And David took something, and in that moment that he took it, sends Bathsheba back home. David does not immediately repent, because that's not what temptation and sin will do to us. They will not encourage us to be honest. They will encourage us to lie and to hide. It encourages compromise. And those things that caused alarm no longer cause alarm. It begins to help us justify what we know is not justifiable. Oh, my word. David ends up creating this whole plan and has Uriah killed. If you've never read that story, y'all, you need to. One thing led to another thing, led to another thing, led to another thing. It's the same in our lives. That's the way that the enemy works. Temptation is always going to take more from you. Sin is always going to take more from you than it will ever give you. Ever. The original offer looks so great. You ever bought something on sale? I'm telling you straightforward. This is one of the things that is very odd about your pastor. When we go to the fair and we walk through those little buildings and you have those people that say, hey, come over here, I want to show you the Kitchenmatic 2000. You can put 27,000 vegetables in here and go like this and it creates this beautiful tossed salad. You should have this. You should buy it. It works so great. He's the one that buys it. I'm not joking you. I can't take him to the fair in Oklahoma anymore, because it's like the Made for Oklahoma building, which is where all that kind of stuff is. It's like, welcome Edgar Ayala, our valued patron. There's like banners out front for him. It didn't work. It worked the first time he ever used it, and then he put too many vegetables in it, and that was the end of that, because he bent the, there's a whole thing. It's a whole thing. It's a whole thing. It's nothing to do with David. But I'm just saying, sometimes sin looks like it's going to be this great thing. It can be very enticing, but it's always going to take more from you than it will ever forgive you. And it's heartbreaking to see that David found that out, because what sin took from him affected his family forever. In verse 26 of chapter 11, it says this: when Bathsheba heard that her husband was dead, she cried for him. She cried for him. You know what? I don't think probably that when all this started for her, she had any intention of it being this. Can you imagine the king sends for you? Your husband's been gone forever. I'm not saying that she was right, because if you hear me say that, you ain't listening, okay? But I'm saying I don't think she ever thought it was going to be to the point that the king would have her husband killed. And her heart broke. I believe she probably loved Uriah. I do. I know Uriah loved her because he was a man of honor. And we saw that through this chapter and through this story. She wasn't ever getting that back. Her sin took that from her. That baby that she was carrying, we can read in in chapter 12, verses 18 and 19. On the seventh day, the baby died. And David's servants were afraid to tell him that the baby was dead. And they said, "Look, we've tried to talk to David while the baby was alive, but he refused to listen to us. If we tell him the baby's dead, he may do something awful." But when David saw his servants whispering, he knew that the baby was dead, and so he asked them, "Is the baby dead?" They answered, "Yes, he is dead." Sin is going to take more from you than it will ever give you. I don't know how else to say this to you this morning. It's not worth it. It's not worth it. And again, I'm going to say this, and I'm going to say this, and I'm going to say this. This is not just about sexual immorality. This covers so many different aspects of our life. The principle of temptation and sin is the same no matter the situation. Sin is sin. We gotta stop the levels of sin in our minds. This is a level 1 sin. This is a level 10 sin. This is a DEFCON 5 sin. This is a DEFCON 1 sin. Stop. Sin is sin. God sees it all the same. Recognize when the enemy is bringing these things, trying to ebb away, trying to chip away at your moral and your spiritual strength and fiber. You have to be the one to stop it. So how do we do that? How do we stop it? How do we do that? Well, I love that we know we can pray. Do you one time see in chapter 11 where David called on the Lord? I'll answer that for you, no. Not one time. Not one time did he inquire of the Lord. I wonder what the outcome would have been if the minute he stood on that balcony, that rooftop, and saw that chick over there in her bathtub, if he first of all would have, what we call in youth ministry, bounced his eyes, okay? Everybody do that with me. Bounce my eyes, okay? If he would have bounced his eyes, and the minute that attraction welled up in his tummy, he would have said, "Oh, Lord, forgive me right now. Lord, meet me where I'm at. Woo! Lord, I have already crossed the line, and I need your a complete and total forgiveness. I am coming to you right now because I need some help." He didn't do that. In Luke chapter 22, verse 40, it says, "Pray that you will not fall into temptation." Pray. Y'all, can I tell you, some of us, the only time we pray is over our meals. We bow our heads when we pray here in the sanctuary. I'm talking about this kind of prayer. I'm talking about the kind of prayer where you are so completely locked in and keyed into your relationship with the Lord that you cannot move until you have encountered that moment with Him. That's the kind of prayer I'm talking about. And I'm not talking about once a week. I'm talking about every single day. Every single day. Stephanie, I don't have that. You do have that time. Because we have the time and the money for the things we want to have the time and the money for. I'm asking you, are you praying? And is that prayer and that time with the Lord so valuable to you that the enemy is even almost cautious to throw the temptation at you because he knows that there's going to be just that complete hem or hedge that's repelling him? Oh, that he would see that in my life. Oh, that he would see that in my life. We got to pray. We got to resist it. It's a choice. Do y'all understand that? It is a choice. And it sounds so, I feel like I'm sometimes, it's almost like children's church. Are you making good choices? We joke around a lot of times in our house because somebody will do something and we'll go, in our house, that's what we call a bad choice. We kind of giggle about that. But I wonder how many of us literally might need to look in the mirror and go, that's going to be a bad choice. Scripture says, submit yourselves to God. Uh-oh, there's that prayer thing again. Because if I am under his submission, you know what the end of that says? Submit yourself to God. And then it says, resist the devil. And then what? He will flee. But you know what? It's going to be hard for me to resist the devil if I'm not under submission over here. They work together. They totally work together. We got to pray, we got to resist, and we got to realize it's not over. Again, I'm going back to something I said earlier. He's not going to stop. He's not going to stop. And here's the thing about him. He knows what gets under our skin. He knows those things that catch our eyes. He is wily like that. I like that word, wily. I don't even know what that means, but it sounds really cool to say. I mean, I do know what it means. Anyway, he's very smart. He's very sneaky. And it's interesting because the minute that Stephanie steps out of this submission and tries to step out, I can take a half a step away from that submission. He is right here in my face. And you know what's good? Let me tell you right now, I know how he works because I'm bringing this today. And if you think for a minute this week I'm not going to have to hole up under the submission, you're crazy. Because I'm stirring some stuff up for me this week. That's a scary thought. But see, what he doesn't know is I know that he's going to be out there. And I'm calling him out for the liar, the cheat, and the snake that he is. That's what I'm doing today. And I love this because even Jesus knew he didn't stop. Because at the end of his time in the wilderness, when the enemy was tempting Jesus, it says this, watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. In Luke 4:13, this is where I was at. After the devil had tempted Jesus in every way. So whatever it is that your struggle is, Jesus was there. He's already walked it. He's put your shoes on, he's laced them up, and he's already been there. Because this tells me, after Jesus was tempted in every way, he left him. The enemy left him until an opportune time. He was constantly, even after Jesus, y'all. Constantly. What you and I face, man, he faced too. That's why he has such great compassion for us. So yeah, we got to pray. We got to resist. We got to realize that he's on the onslaught. But do you know what else we need? We need some accountability. Oh, this is not my favorite thing to talk about. We need some accountability. Obviously, our first level of accountability is right here. And in Psalm 139, where we've been all weekend, the very last two verses of that chapter say this: God, examine me and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is anything bad in me. Lead me on the road to everlasting. The very first part of that chapter opens up and says, Lord, you've examined me and you know all about me. You have searched me and you know me. Can I tell you this morning, all of those things that none of us can see, he does. And he still wants you. And he still wants you. Our first level of accountability has to come from that relationship with the Father. It has to come in those times where we're submitted to him. That submission is constant. Again, I'm going to say that until it literally sinks into your head. We have to keep our hearts open before an ever-searching eye of the Father. The minute we close that heart off to him, we step out from underneath that submission. That very moment. We need to find somebody here that will seek the Lord on our behalf and not be able to tell us the truth. I mean, and be able to tell us the truth, not afraid. Woo! Time out! Whoa! No. We need to find somebody that will seek the Lord on our behalf and not be afraid to tell us the truth. Tell us those things that we don't want to hear. David had a servant. David had a servant that loved him so much, that wanted to please his king, that wanted to do everything he could to make his king successful, all the way to the point that right before David jumps off of a cliff, he's going, she's the wife of Uriah the Hittite. Don't do it. It's not worth it. And David completely disregarded that. Until Nathan the prophet came in and said, oh, dude, this ain't good. It's not good. If you surround yourself with people that tell you only what you want to hear, you're not living in a level of accountability. You're living at a carnival. And at some point, the bolts are going to come out of the tilt-a-whirl, and you're going to go flying. You need to find somebody in your life that will look at you and say, nope, you're wrong. That's not lined up with God's word at all. You know what? Sometimes it needs to be somebody that'll go, I hear your situation, but that's not their problem. You're the problem. You need to get back over here under the submission and authority of God. You know what? We're scared to do that. And the funny thing is we all say, yes, we need those people in our lives. Absolutely, we need those people in our lives. And we find that person in our life. And we have a situation that comes up, and we go to that person, and I need an accountability partner, and this is where I am. And that person speaks truth to us, and what do? We get mad at them. What? They're doing exactly what you've asked them to do. They're saying exactly, hopefully, what the Lord has laid on their hearts to tell you. And we have the crazy audacity to get mad at them because they love us enough to tell the truth? Grow up. Some of us need to grow up. That is one of the most terrifying things about believers sometimes, is we want to speak the truth to everybody else, but we don't want to hear the truth when somebody has to speak something to us that we don't want to hear, that might cause us to have to repent and make some changes. When we start living like that, we're living in a dangerous day and age in our lives. When accountability is spoken into us, we need to understand that it should produce repentance. In chapter 12, Nathan comes to David and lays it all out. And in verse 13, David simply says this: "Then David said to Nathan, 'I have sinned against the Lord. I'm caught. I'm caught, Nathan. I don't even know what I was thinking. I don't know how I got here.' And Nathan said this: 'The Lord has taken away your sin and you will not die. But what you did caused the Lord's enemies to lose all respect for him. And for this reason, the son who was born to you will die.'" Nathan went on to tell David that because of his choices and because of this moment, that the sword would never depart from his house. We serve a very forgiving Father. A very forgiving Father. But make no mistake, we still have consequences to our sins sometimes. We still have consequences to our sins sometimes. You know, this morning, as I'm digging through and reading all of these things, and I'm reflecting back on Psalm 139, this is why I love the life of David so very much. Because this is the man that knew the Lord was going to search him. He was the man that knew that there was no place he could run or hide to escape from the very presence, the abiding presence of the Father. He knew that he had been formed in his mother's womb. And he still made mistakes. And yet God said, "He's a man after my own heart." Not a man after my own heart because he didn't screw up every once in a while. But I believe it's because when he did, he was honestly and openly repentant before the Lord. Honestly and openly repentant before the Lord. I don't know where you are this morning, and I told the girls this weekend. Sometimes we hear the word of the Lord, and it's so applicable to us right now. Like right this minute, we're like, whew. Directly right here. It's like you leave and you're feeling like whoever was delivering the word was like staring at you the whole time when they weren't. But that's just that conviction and that powerful, loving conviction of the Holy Spirit. But sometimes we hear a word from the Lord and he's preparing us for what is to come. And he's asking us to store some of this wisdom and this knowledge up, to dig deep within our spirit and bury that treasure so when the enemy comes on the onslaught, it's already there as a defense for us. And this morning, I don't know where you are. You may be under the full submission of the Holy Spirit and the Lord this morning. Stay there. Stay there. Dwell there. Take up residence there. But this morning, you may have one foot in and one foot out because there's something that's caught your eye. It's not worth it. It's not worth it. For the rest of David's life, he suffered the consequence of one bad choice. One fleeting moment of excitement and passion, and he paid for it. His children paid for it. His grandchildren paid for it. Your choices don't just affect you. Would you stand with me this morning?